out of same fund. Is that still the case now or not? Because of, you know, obviously, I don't know that that was a, something we could do forever.
We have a positive fund balance in food service. We are, so food service is similar to special education in that if there's a deficit balance at the end of the year, the general fund has to buy it out. We've run a positive fund balance, so that is a self-contained program still at this point, and we intend it to stay that way as much as we absolutely can.
One last question. Health insurance, that $800,000, that's from savings that we previously realized from changes in our health insurance, or is this a difference?
That's for changes. So when we switched to the single carrier, we had some staff members who chose to leave our plan. So that savings we're realizing from those. Could we see new hires that are, you know, through transitions now picking up our health insurance? Sure. So we could see that line item of a future cost that we need to project. But that's something that we'll look at once the new open enrollment comes through this fall, if that's a significant change. But
it's one of the larger items in there. So that's what I was curious about. Thank you.
I have a question. The leasing line, and now I can't put my finger on it.
For the bus.
Oh, there it is. Mm-hmm. Is, I know that typically there's turnover in needing new vehicles and stuff like that. Is that, are we not making any purchases of vehicles next year, or are we just reducing what we need to purchase by one bus? It looks like we're taking it out completely and there's nothing being purchased.
That is 1 year's worth of lease payments if we were to add a lease payment for buses for this next school year. Because of the low mileage that we had through COVID, we have not had to replace buses. However, I would expect that you're going to see a few buses this next year as you go into 23-24 because while we've been able to hold off lately, we can't go so long that we find ourselves going backwards in our fleet. So, but yes, we did not have to do any purchasing of vehicles this year.
I was hoping what that meant, and I just wanted to confirm.
Yep. So this, that was early on in prelim. We assumed we were going to go out to bid this spring for an addition for one or two buses, and since we deferred that, that savings, we realized that that's not a payment we're going to have to make next year towards the cost of buses. So the other piece that I wanted to add in the conversation when we were talking about compensation and future CPI increases. So as Lori shared, we have colleagues around the state that do an analysis of looking at CPI projections over using a lot of historical data of where we might be seeing that increase. So I would say a reasonable estimate right now based on some of our colleagues' modeling is anywhere between about 6.8 to 8.15% for CPI going into 23-24 school year. So that's a pretty significant increase yet again going into the next school year. Splitting the difference is about 7.51%. So I share that as a data point as we're having conversations that CPI isn't going to go down going into 23-24. Unless something like a seismic change happens that inflation just plummets and isn't, which we don't anticipate. So it's only going to get larger based on some modeling that colleagues have done. So I share that as we're at looking at 4.7 now, projections for the operating referendum that Dana's gonna share going into 23-24 are at 6%. So if we're looking at more, that's where the conversation about other other funding would need to be provided if we were going to get up to CPI. So just a data point to share as we're making conversations about long-term funding and what impact that has. I also don't anticipate the next biennium budget that the state's going to be like, hey, inflation's really increased. Here's 8% increase on your revenue limit. So, right, we're going to see increasing expenses at a higher rate than we are potentially going to get state funding. So I'm cautious about what we're going to get for state funding based on our modeling. So I just share that our expenses are a lot.
And is our modeling based on, and I apologize for asking this again, but our modeling then in our budget is based on that 4.7 kind of.
For 22-23 school year, it's based on 4.7.
And we could potentially see, based on the data that you just shared, 7.51%. average
for 23-24. Okay. So in the operating referendum going forward, the first 2 years for wages, we're at 6%, assuming that there's going to be some higher inflation. But that still doesn't get us up to where CPI potentially could be. Again, modeling at this time, we don't have a 12-month data point yet for CPI to be determined.
Well, now that we're all depressed,
thank you.
You're depressed. You're welcome.
For that budget update.
Yeah.
But now, since we're looking at money and being depressed, we're done with our information discussion items, and we're going to move on to items for action. Operational referendum decision.
Right. So much of what I was planning on covering in my slides has been really thoughtfully covered in previous items. And so I'm not going to belabor some of these slides here so we can get to the conversation, but I do want to hit on some of the high points if that would be okay with the board. So the point of the action item tonight is to decide if we should go for an operational referendum in November, and if so, how much money should we be asking our community for? We've talked about this all night tonight, but these are the reasons we are where we are right now. This is why we are asking the community for potentially for a referendum. The inadequate funding from the state, the rising inflation that's impacting all aspects of district operations, and we've heard a lot tonight about our student enrollment. All of those things have put us in a place where we are facing some budget uncertainty heading into the next several years. I'm going to skip over all of these slides because we have talked about all of this already, but I do want to center our conversation here. So we've been talking about, you know, what happens, what could happen potentially if we decide not to go for a referendum, or if we do go for a referendum and it fails. And I just want to pause on this slide because I think the data here is just really, really compelling and important. So over the next several years, this shows the projected budget deficit that we would be facing. These are not small numbers. Now, these projections assume no increases in enrollment. So that's important to remember. If we all of a sudden see an influx of kids over time, that's going to help our budget picture, certainly. It also has assumed, as Aaron was explaining, sort of those percentages for inflation at 6%, 6%, et cetera. But, you know, you look at the things that would potentially need to be considered for cutting. This is not an exhaustive list by any stretch, but you can see as you kind of go down those bullet points, as was mentioned earlier, we would start, you know, looking at people in positions farthest away from the classroom. But then over time, we'd be looking at things like class size, extracurricular offerings and athletic offerings, deferring capital maintenance on our buildings and facilities, potentially school consolidation. I mean, these are really big challenges and issues that if we aren't able to do something significant in getting more revenue, that the board and our district administrative team will have to consider. You're all well aware that we contracted with the Donovan Group. We've done quite a bit of community engagement since January. We had some face-to-face sessions. We had some Zoom sessions. Recently, we had a large survey, and we had nearly 2,000 responses. I want to highlight some of those responses here tonight because I think it's important for the conversation that's going to ensue. So one of the questions I pulled from the Donovan report that was presented last time, the question is, I believe the school district's most urgent financial needs must be addressed now. You remember, Perry kind of separated the data into three groups, district families, the comparison group, those are folks who don't have kids in school, so, you know, currently, and then there's sort of this weighted average between the two groups with more weight given to community members without children. You can see there is a belief that we should be doing something now about our current financial needs. Next question, how likely are you to support an operational referendum on the November 22 ballot? Again, there is strong support here from our entire community for us to be really having this conversation, which is great. We did some checking with our community about their potential support for three different dollar amounts, $20 million, $24.9 million, and $30 million. Again, the forecasting and the modeling here is really important, but I think there are some distinct differences or a distinct difference across the three amounts that we just need to be aware of. Again, with a lot of unknowns on the horizon, but the 20 million mark is certainly going to help. 20 million is not a small number, but we would need to continue to look for places to cut. If that was the dollar amount that the board decided to go to the community for. The 24.9 amount, again, largely we think we'd be able to be sort of maintaining our current staffing levels and programming. However, again, if those inflation costs go way up, then we're going to need to continue to find places and spaces where we're going to cut. At the 30 million mark, that might, big emphasis on might, allow us to add, potentially in some targeted areas. And so largely that's sort of how we are thinking about those $3 amounts. A lot of information on this slide, I realize, but you can kind of see what the levels of support are across the three groups, the district families, comparison group, and weighted average, for those $3 amounts. And as the dollar amount gets larger, the level of support goes down a bit. So there seems to be, according to this information, some pretty strong levels of support for 20 million and 24.9, and a little bit less support at that $30 million mark. So considering all of the data, the information that we have gotten over the past several months, all of the community input sessions, the lots of conversations and presentations that we have given to service organizations, to PTAs, PTOs, the survey data, we believe this is perhaps a logical place to start the conversation this evening, and that would be to go ahead and move to approve an operational referendum for November 2022, asking for the amount of $24.9 million over a four-year period. Just as a reminder, you saw this information before, but the tax impact there is listed, and that is a projected increase of $135 over a four-year period on $100,000 of assessed property value. And you can see in the first year, the impact is pretty small and then gets larger as the years go on. So just to kind of summarize all of the information that was included and many of the points that were made tonight, we feel good about that $24.9 million amount to begin the discussion tonight. So with that, we will turn it over to the board for conversation and discussion.
Maybe nobody knows the answer to this, but hopefully somebody does. I know the city of Middleton was considering going to referendum. Does anyone have any updates on that? Does anyone know if they decided to do it, and if so, are they asking for a specific amount like we are?
I do have an update with respect to that. They have had a conversation in open session. The dollar amount is not in front of me right now, but I want to say it's around $500,000 for emergency services specifically. I recently just met the new city administrator, and he let me know they're continuing to ponder whether or not their timeline is still feels good, and are having conversations about potentially still going in November or potentially thinking about April. Instead or the following. So I think there's still some fluidity in their process.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
And just to kind of follow up on that, based on our experience in passing a referendum, they're getting past that window where they can successfully start talking about and working into a referendum for November. If you're planning backwards, it's, July. Mm-hmm. So if they don't pull that trigger in the next month or so, I think they'll have a difficult time just having something, a package to put together. But, it is what it is, because it's only $500,000 versus what we're looking for. But it's just the idea of competing, I'm right with you, Paul,
right,
competing with somebody on that at the same time. That same question on the ballot was against somebody else.
Yeah.
Right.
So tying this conversation back to the compensation discussion, as I look at the slide with the projected budget deficits, then are we essentially talking about with option, compensation option one, adding $438,000 to each of these projected budget deficits, or 271 under option two. That's what we're talking about, right?
Or, yeah.
Yeah, because it was the, your projections in year one. Well, wait, no, the referendum does not include 2223, yep.
But as of right now, the restructures are coming from within the budget, so we would be reducing something else in the budget to make up for it. So we are finding the money in our current budget.
Right,
if we don't reprioritize it, it would be a permanent decrease, which would make those numbers still accurate.
Thank you.
I'm wondering about, and I don't know that we've talked about this a whole lot, the definitely not support it group is the second largest percentage. I'm wondering if we've received any if there was any feedback from that group within the survey that would give us some information that would help.
You know, in conversations with Perry, looking at survey comments and some of the things we gleaned from some of our engagement sessions, I think there were a couple themes of feedback that I would connect to probably definitely not support it. One would be just all families are dealing with their own, you know, financial issues aligned with inflation, and just the thought of additional tax monies is just too much for their own family budget. I think that was probably a strong theme. A second theme is still some frustration over how the district handled the pandemic and remaining in a virtual setting for as long as we did. That came up in many different areas. The fact that we recently went to the community in 2018 wasn't that long ago, you know, for a very large referendum that resulted in Pope Farm and the high school. And I think just some questions around, you know, why has the data changed so significantly when it comes to enrollment and that kind of thing. So I don't know if there's any other theme looking at Lori, because she was in all those sessions with me, but I think those are the high points.
I'm looking at the 24.9, which is one that I favor. I'm assuming, just if we're as we're looking at this, I'm trying to only concentrate on the data, which is important, and the weighted average is probably what we should be looking at for a number. So weighted for support, definitely support, and would probably support equals basically 45%. So we're planning on picking up the undecided at least 5 of that 18 to 6%, so a third of those. We're planning to pick up about a third of the undecided.
Yeah, and that was something Perry was really adamant about when he presented to us, that is an encouraging number to us, because hopefully through good community engagement education, we'd be able to capture some of the undecided.
And that's actually was my point, was that for us to capture that last group of that 18.4%, well, the amount of effort we put into getting our message out will pay off that difference, pick up that 5 or 6% that we need to get it passed.
I hear a lot of thinking. I don't hear a motion yet.
I'd like to make a motion to accept the recommendation for $24.9 million.
Do we have a motion? Do we have a second?
I'll second.
Can I ask a question? Does it have to be worded like you did for the purposes of anything?
No.
Okay.
No, you can word it however you like to.
Got it.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Further discussion?
I'm assuming, Bob, you're saying November 2022.
I'm going to go with the recommendations made by administration.
Okay, hearing no further. Wait, Brian.
I guess just the, do we need to specify that it would be non-recurring? That was that issue before, too. I don't see that noted here.
I'll redo the motion then.
That's a good detail, Brian. Yeah.
Move to approve an operational referendum question on November 2022. For the amount of $24.9 million over a four-year period.
I'll second.
Okay.
Okay, we didn't, it didn't say non-recurring.
He didn't say non-recurring in that. There was no non-recurring.
No, I said over a four-year period.
That's what it says. It says over a four-year period.
Yeah.
Yeah, I guess that captures it.
Which I guess by definition is non-recurring.
Yeah, okay. It would be non-recurring.
I thought we were looking for the word, that's why.
Me too.
That's why I got confused.
We're all
at least we know everyone's listening.
Understood.
I'll give everyone 2-second count for further discussion. Hearing none. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion passes. Okay, approval of Pope Farm Lot offers.
So when the district originally purchased the land that Pope Farm Elementary was built on, there was an understanding even back then that there was going to be a portion of the land that we would be able to create lots off and sell to use either for the purchase of additional land if we thought we might need a future land site, or to invest in other capital reasons. So we find ourselves actually at a point where we can sell these lots. The board decided to individually sell each of these lots as opposed to as a whole last fall, and so we went to RFP for a real estate agent and started working with Josh Blasey from Restaino and Associates. The Pope Farm lots, or Pope Farm Estate as we called it, were put on the market a few weeks ago with an understanding that they would have all of their bids in and that we would not be able to take action until tonight. So I created with Josh's help, a summary sheet that identifies the lots that we received bids on. We have 16 lots that are across the road from Pope Farm Elementary. We have received bids on 6 of them so far. Lot 2, Lot 4, Lot 13, and Lot 16 all received one bid, which is identified for you with information about the purchase price that they're offering, the closing date, earnest money, and the type of financing they would need. For lots 15 and lot 17, we actually received 2 bids. And so the bid that is highlighted is the recommended offer. We're not sharing the purchaser or the person who's bid and the amount that they're bidding, because that will impact our ability to negotiate on the remaining lots that are still up for sale. So in most of the instances, they're cash offers. There are only a few of them that are looking at actually going for financing. All of them are putting down earnest money, and all of them are looking at closing either the very end of June or by the end of July. So I am recommending that the board approve the offers on lots 2, 4, 13, 15, 16, and 17 as presented, but then also to direct and authorize the officers, employees, or agents of the district to do any and all things reasonably necessary to accomplish the purchase of the approval. And that language just essentially is saying, you're going to let me sign the offer and send Jared sign the closing documents when we move forward, so that you don't have to be present.
What you just said, so moved. So I don't have to repeat it.
That's a lot.
Second.
Discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion passes.
You want these back, right?
I can take those back, yep.
A quick question, which you may not know the answer. The people who did not, 2 people who will not get the bids, do you think there's a possibility that they may make an offer on another lot?
They could. They could. They haven't indicated that to us at this point, but I'm sure they might have been waiting to see where everything else ended up and then may look.
Yeah, it'd be nice.
The last agenda item is also mine, so I feel
Hey, wait, I'm supposed to call that out.
I'm sorry.
Okay, Lori's going to talk about the last agenda item, facilities use schedule for schools and performing arts center. Thank you, Lori, please.
I'm on a roll, so I'm going to cover the PAC first. There were no changes, so we could move on and actually look at the facilities. So we brought this forward at the last board meeting, and there was concerns about the increases, and so I said I would take that back and relook at it. and maybe be much more clear on what the changes are. So what you have in your packet, I'm going to just kind of very quickly go through it. And when I look at the actual user classifications, I highlighted those areas where there's been a change. If you'll notice, I added the Pope Farm Friends to Group 3. That's because we have the Friends of Pheasant Branch on there, and the board was very purposeful when they built Cromery and when they built Pope Farm, that there was a room there for those groups to be able to come in, use the facilities, have meetings, and so that we were really thoughtful and intentional about creating partnerships with them because of the locations of those schools. And they weren't represented on this document. Over in the facility class categories, we are recommending that we move the Glacier Creek Middle School field house up to a class one, primarily because of the size and the fact that that has air conditioning, just like the high school. So that was a recommendation. We're also recommending adding a class 1B for both the Pope Farm Gymnasium and the Glacier Creek Middle School gym. And the only reason that they would be moving up into their own separate classification is because of what their floor is made of. And the cost of maintaining that floor is more expensive than the gyms that are recognized in class 2 or in class 3. We're adding the Pope Farm cafetorium space to the class 2 facilities. That's a new space that wasn't even reflected on the schedule before, but that people want to use because of the size and the agility of that space to be used for multiple purposes. And if you'll notice, we moved the high school art gallery down. What used to be the art gallery in our previous high school was multi-purpose. It could be used as a classroom, it could be used as a gallery, it could be used for a lot of different purposes, whereas the room that it's in right now is really just a very small room that's really more about showcasing and not so much about using it for people to do things within. So those are the changes that we would be looking at from a user group standpoint. When we look at the actual facility use schedule, what I did was I struck through the amount that we're recommending changing and then added in and highlighted yellow what we'd be recommending the change to. When we compared ourselves to a lot of school districts and then really focused in on Sun Prairie and Verona because we were most closely aligned to them, what I did was try to create a halfway spot in between the two. And where we were are the lowest was not in our group fours and group fives, but we were low in our group 3 and 3A. And while I completely understand the fact that we want to encourage our facility use, I want to consider make sure our facilities are available for facility use. I also know that we represent a group of constituents that also don't want to pay extra in taxes because we're using our facilities for outside community use. And it's really a delicate balance to find that line to make sure our buildings are being used and we're respecting the wishes of all taxpayers. I also have updated each of the electrical, so for the stadium or the baseball field lights, I increased all of them right about 10%, but I rounded them to whole dollars so that we weren't messing with 50%. So those are the changes that I'm recommending in our facility use fee schedule, knowing that if the board is not comfortable with these changes, the board can certainly look at doing even more of a leveled up spot for facility use, but I would want you to tell me what you'd like those numbers to be tonight because people are wanting to try to get the facilities scheduled. So I'll entertain for questions or whatever else you'd like to add.
Can I ask a question? Where does the Middleton Community Orchestra fit on here?
They would be a group 4 because they are a non-resident or a
resident, a but non-profit school
group, and not they're not group. They're okay. Not the school.
I just was curious where they fit on the grid.
They would fit on a group 4.
Other questions? Is there a motion?
I'll move approval of the recommended changes.
Second.
Further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion passes. Okay, we're going to talk real briefly about next meeting dates, because during the agenda setting committee, discussion came up once again on farm lot offers. We have to kind of do those, approval of them in a timely fashion. And the agenda committee discussed the idea, we have to, by the way, have to have a quorum and have to approve it, just like we did on the lots we approved tonight.
You have to be here present.
Yes, we have to be physically present. And so the agenda committee thought the time to do that would be to set it up on Thursdays at 7 p.m., if we need to, if we need to. If there's an offer there, we show up at 7, we spend 2 or 3 hours discussing the offer, and then we're out of here in 15 minutes. So that's kind of the plan. I think the only one who wasn't here for that was Paul, matter of fact. Paul. So Paul, we're really just talking to you here.
And
Paul, this is kind of the idea.
I don't know if it's good news or bad news, but every Thursday night at 7 o'clock through the summer, I'm booked.
As long as you're not doing like your favorite show's on or something like that.
No, I've got to get my youngest to her Oregon 3v3.
Okay, as long as we have a quorum, that means we need five people.
So we can only lose two.
We can only lose two people.
We only need four if we're eight.
I thought we had five.
We'll need five?
Yeah, because four is a tie. It's not a majority.
So anyways, keep your ear close to the phone. We will be noting the meeting.
We'll get them on your respective calendars. We'll get them on your calendars probably in the next couple of weeks. And then if we have to remove them because there is no offer, then we'll remove them as quickly as we are able.
Besides the special meetings that might happen, the only other ones we have are coming.
Brian has a question.
Oh, sorry, Brian.
I'll stand a better chance of being able to make those if we could make it 7:15.
I'm sorry, say again?
I have a materially better chance of making it to those Thursday meetings if it's 7:15 versus 7. Would that work for you? Mm-hmm.
In the spirit of fraternity, should we make it 7:15?
Can we just go with 7:30?
Yeah,
7:30. Let's do it. Sorry to push
or
it one
is
more
that
time.
Too much?
Okay, well, 7:30. That's before I go to bed, so you know, okay, being the old man in the room. Okay, then why don't we plan on 7:30? Put in your schedule as a maybe for the next few Thursdays coming along. And we need a quorum at 7:30. Okay, we have a meeting here at the end of the month. 14 days from today, we'll be meeting again for our next board meeting. I'm looking for a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
Thank goodness we got a second. I know we're having fun here, but come on, guys, it's time to go home. Okay, we have a motion, a second. Discussion hearing none. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Nay. Motion passes.
Nice.
Yeah. Okay. I thought Gail was going to second it. And then I saw you open your mouth, and I was like, oh, Gail's got it.
I always second the ones to adjourn.
You